Welcome to our JavaScript web course. In this video, we will go over some basic concepts to introduce the document object model, or DOM, the getElementById method, the inner HTML property, and the click event. JavaScript is an object-based language, and when we use the language, we use the objects. We have what are called browser objects, such as the window object, history, screen, and location. We will cover some of those objects later. We also have the document object, and that refers to the page itself and the contents in the page. Objects contain methods, properties, and events can be connected to the objects. By using these methods, properties, and events, we make things happen in the web page using JavaScript. The document object model, or DOM, is unique to the web browser environment. It does not exist anywhere else. It does not apply to the web server. It does not apply to the desktop computer. It is based on the structure of the web page, the elements, attributes, and text. Here we see a layout of the web page. Notice that the elements form a tree structure or parent-child relationship. You may have heard of the DOM in a CSS class because our CSS pseudo-classes are based on DOM relationships also. The official document object model is a World Wide Web Consortium standard. It defines a standard for accessing documents and accessing the elements and content on the page. It gives us standards for how to change, add, or delete these elements, attributes, and values. So by using the DOM, JavaScript can change the HTML, it can change the attributes, it can change the CSS styles, it can remove existing elements and attributes. It can add new elements and attributes. It can react to the events on the page, and it can actually create new events. One very common way to access an element on the web page is by using the getElementById method. If you recall in CSS, ID values are unique, meaning we only have one of each of that value in the document. For example, here I have PID equals demo. That means that there will not be another ID equals demo in this page. There will be more IDs, but not the value of demo. So how we would access that element is by using this method. And this method is a method of the document object, so the syntax is document.getElementById, and in parentheses we have the value of the ID attribute, which is demo. Similar to functions, methods are always followed by parentheses. If you recall, when we used document.write, we were accessing the write method of the document object. So getElementById allows us to essentially reference or point to that object. However, it doesn't do anything else. It just tells us where the object is that we are going to be using. The inner HTML property refers to the value inside an HTML element. As you know, HTML elements contain content. They can contain text. They can also contain other HTML elements. So the inner HTML property refers to both the text and HTML inside an element. So here we have this paragraph, ID equals demo, and the inner HTML value would be placed inside the opening and closing P tag. Now in our script tag, we have the statement document.getElementById.demo.innerHTML equals, in quotations, because this is a literal, the opening B tag, hello world, the closing B tag, semicolon. Let's take a look at this expression. Number one, it uses dot syntax. Object.method.property equals a value. So what is on the right is assigned to what is on the left. What is on the left is pointing to what is inside the opening and closing P tag. GetElementById was a stepping stone in identifying the P. InnerHTML is the property that places a value inside that P. Okay, let's also take a look at this syntax. JavaScript is a case-sensitive language. If you do not spell the methods and properties using this case, it will not work. Notice JavaScript uses the camel case syntax for all its methods. We also have an innertext property. The innertext property works the same way as the innerHTML property, except that it only refers to the ability to place text inside the opening and closing tags of that element. You will see that most developers use innerHTML even for text. It seems to be the standard. Now, supposing we wanted to click on something and change the text of another element. This would involve using the click event, and you may hear the term event handling. So we are going to handle an event on the web page. So here I have a function, and that function is going to call a simple alert. Now I have my P with ID equals demo, and now I have my script. Here I have my document.getElementById demo, and I'm storing that reference in a variable using the let keyword. This is a common practice in JavaScript programming. Rather than always typing out document.getElementById, it is more efficient to store that reference in a variable and then use the variable wherever needed in the page. So here we have this reference being stored in a variable myDemo. So now I can access that object when it is clicked on. So the statement myDemo.onClick equals change means when that paragraph is clicked on, we call the change function. So when working with the click event in traditional JavaScript, the name of the event is preceded by an on. Notice this is all lowercase. So this is how we set up a click event. And when someone clicks on that paragraph, it will call that function change. Remember, we learned that functions are not executed until they are called. Notice in the statement where we are handling this event, the function name does not have the parentheses after it. And that is the syntax for calling a function when we use a click event. If you were to put the parentheses there, it would automatically execute. So you do not use parentheses when calling the function with an event handler. I would also like to point out that whenever you set up a function call with a click event, the best way to test that you are accurately calling that function is to place an alert inside the function before you write any function code. First, make sure you can call that function. It does no good to write a lot of code and then you click and nothing happens. You don't know whether the error is in the code or whether you didn't call that function right. So always put an alert there, test the function call, and then write the code. Now, supposing we wanted to call a function that has a parameter and we need to pass an argument to that function. We learned that when you have an event that the function name cannot have parentheses after it. So how would we pass an argument? Well, in this case, you actually need to call an anonymous function, as I have here. That anonymous function will contain the function with the argument that will be passed to the function with the parameter. I would like to point out something you may see in a textbook or on the web. In the early days of JavaScript, developers placed an onClick event handler inside the HTML element to call a function. That was before the introduction of the DOM, because that was the only way to click on something on the web page. That is old code. That is not allowed in this class. Should you submit an application with any kind of event being used as an HTML attribute, you will receive a 0.